Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjali Ammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Koyilvanni. I am happy to meet you again in the video lecture on Engineering Thermodynamics. We are discussing on the steam power cycle, and this is lecture number 7 on the steam power cycle or vapor power cycle. And we recap from the previous lectures. So in the previous 6 lectures, we studied about the Rankine cycle, reheat Rankine cycle, regenerative Rankine cycle, and we solved problems from the Rankine cycle, reheat cycle and the regenerative cycle from the Anna University question paper. And the topic for this lecture is binary vapor cycle, cogeneration and the combined cycle and coupled cycle. So these are all the topics for the 7th lecture. The learning outcome to the students: at the end of the lecture, the student will be able to explain the working of binary vapor cycle, the student will be able to describe the working of cogeneration cycle, and the student will be able to discuss the coupled and combined cycle. Binary vapor cycle. So a vapor cycle, that is a combination of two cycles. One is a high temperature region and other one is in low temperature region. So this is what a binary vapor power cycle. So two vapor power cycle, one is operating at a higher temperature, another one is operating at a lower temperature. The popular cycle is mercury cycle combined with the steam power cycle. So listen to the diagram. You take few seconds and listen to the diagram, the layout diagram and the temperature entropy diagram for the binary vapor cycle, which is mercury steam cycle. So the high temperature cycle is mercury cycle and the low temperature cycle is steam cycle. So the layout, we start from here for mercury cycle 0.1. So this is liquid mercury. So we have a mercury pump, so which is pumping the mercury at a higher pressure to a boiler, mercury boiler. So here the mercury liquid is converted into mercury vapor. The saturation temperature of mercury at 12 bar is 560 degrees Celsius. So the temperature is higher. So the mercury vapor is formed in the boiler, mercury boiler, and with the vapor at a higher temperature, it is entering the mercury turbine, where the vapor is expanded and the power is produced. Then after expansion, so this becomes again, look at the point here. So this is the superheated vapor again. So the vapor, mercury vapor, goes to the heat exchanger, where it loses its heat energy. So the heat from the mercury vapor is reduced and it is converted into mercury liquid and circulated again to the mercury pump. And look at the diagram. So 1 to 2 is the pump work, isentropic compression. 2 to 3 is the heat addition in the boiler, where the liquid is converted into superheated vapor, and 3 to 4 it is expansion, isentropic expansion, where the superheated vapor is converted into wet vapor, then the wet vapor then is cooled in the heat exchanger and converted into liquid. So this is the mercury cycle. Now the heat exchanger, so the heat exchanger is used as a source of heat energy for another cycle, the steam power cycle. For the vapor power cycle or the steam power cycle, so we have the pump again. So the liquid, saturated, unsaturated liquid at the 0.6, it enters the heat exchanger. So here the heat transfer is taking place from the mercury vapor to the water. So the water is converted into steam. So look at the steam power cycle. So it is low temperature cycle. So 6 is the point, 6 is the condition at the entry of the heat exchanger. It absorbs the heat from the heat exchanger and it is converted into vapor, and again we have a superheater where additional heat is supplied and it becomes superheated steam. So 7 is the superheated steam, where the 7 superheated steam is expanded in the steam turbine and it is converted into wet steam. So the expansion, it produces work again, and with the condition 8, it goes to the condenser, where the heat is removed and the steam is converted into liquid water, and then the water is pumped back to the steam, through the steam pump again, it is recirculated back to the heat exchanger. So at the 5 is the wet steam, and 8 is the wet steam, 8 to 5. So this 5 is the point where it is the entry of the pump. So it is actually water pump. So pump is circulating the water once again to the heat exchanger. So the two cycles, so this is mercury is a higher temperature cycle because the saturation temperature of vaporization temperature of mercury is higher than the water. So this is called as high temperature cycle and this is called as low temperature cycle. And this binary vapor power cycle, it is used normally when you want to achieve higher efficiency of the vapor power cycle, we will go for the binary vapor power cycle. And in the cycle, mercury steam binary cycle, the topping cycle is called as mercury cycle. Actually, the cycle which is operating at the top of the total system is called as topping cycle, and the cycle which is operating at lower temperature is called as bottoming cycle. The steam cycle is the bottoming cycle and mercury cycle is the topping cycle. So when they ask a question on the binary vapor cycle, so you have to define what is a binary vapor cycle. Carefully draw the layout diagram and the temperature entropy diagram. You explain one by one. So you explain the each component and the process in each component, and you can consolidate the mercury cycle and the steam cycle. And you can mention the mercury cycle is a high temperature cycle and the steam cycle is the low temperature cycle. Cogeneration. So cogeneration is another newer technology. So cogeneration is production of more than one useful form of energy, such as process heat and electric power from the same energy source. So there will be one heat supply. So from the heat, one heat supply, one source of heat supply, we produce process heat as well as electric power. That is called as cogeneration. So generating electric power and heat, that is what the cogeneration. So you look at the steam power plant. So the normally this cogeneration plant is available almost in all the sugar factories where you find a steam power plant. So in the sugar factory, we require power. The power is produced by the steam power plant. The steam outlet of the turbine, it is used for process heating. That is, to heat the molasses of the sugarcane juice, we are using the steam outlet of the turbine. So where for heating the sugarcane juice, we require heat as well as water. So to purify, to extract the sugar, so we require the process heater. And the boiler, so the amount of heat, actually boiler is a device where the water is converted into steam, and the steam is taken to the turbine where the steam is expanded and the power is produced. Then the exhaust steam from the turbine, it is used in the process heater. So in the process heater, the steam is used. So after heating, the water is coming out. Then the water is pumped back to the boiler using a pump. Just for a numerical understanding, so we assume 120 kilowatt of heat is given in the boiler. So out of 120, so this 120 kilowatt is used for converting water into steam. So the steam power is now 120 kilowatts. So out of the 120 kilowatts, 20 kilowatts produced as a power, mechanical power. The remaining 100 kilowatt is used in the process heater, and it is used for the heating of heat is used for any industrial process. And this is called a simple cogeneration plant. Now we have an ideal cogeneration plant. So this is yet a small modification in the system. You look at the diagram. So the boiler is here, and you have a expansion valve, turbine, process heater, condenser, pump 1 and pump 2. So the boiler is producing the steam, high temperature, high pressure steam, and the steam is through the pipeline, it is taken to the turbine as well as through the expansion valve to the process heater. So some portion of the steam is going to the turbine, some other portion of the steam is going to the process heater through the expansion valve. In the steam turbine also, a small amount of steam is taken at the condition 6 and is given to the process heater. Then after the turbine, the steam, actually the exhaust steam, it goes to the condenser. So in the condenser, it is condensed and then recirculated back through the pump, it is recirculated back to the boiler, and the outlet of the process heater is also circulated back to the boiler through the pump 1. So in the ideal cogeneration plant, what is the advantage is, depending on the requirement of steam, suppose if you want to produce more power and you require lesser amount of heat energy for the process heat, so we can regulate the valve such that more amount of steam is going to the steam turbine and less amount of steam is going to the process heater. Suppose if you want to produce lesser power and more more steam for the process heater, in that case we can open the valve more and more amount of steam will be circulated to the process heater and less amount of steam circulated to the turbine. So that advantage is available in the ideal cogeneration plant. So that is why this is the modified version of the previous simple cogeneration plant. The pump 1, pump 2, they are taking power from the steam turbine and the remaining power is available as a external work. And this cogeneration plant is very popular. Then the standard cogeneration plant of the TS diagram, temperature entropy diagram. So you look at the layout. So we have a boiler, steam turbine, expansion valve, process heater, and then pump 1, pump 2, condenser, and there is one additional component called mixing chamber. So the mixing chamber, it was missing in the previous layout. So mixing chamber, it gives additional advantage. So the output from the pump 1 and pump 2, they are mixed here, and then the water with the condition 11 is circulated back to the boiler. So the operation is, so the boiler is producing the steam, the high pressure steam, it is circulated to the turbine and partially to the process heater through the expansion valve. And the outlet of the turbine, it is condensed, the steam is condensed here and the condensate is circulated back to the mixing chamber using the pump 1, and in the process heater through the valve, at the outlet of the process heater, it is again circulated back to the mixing chamber through the pump 2, and these two are, so this is again saturated liquid, this is also almost saturated unsaturated liquid, so these two are mixed together here and it is circulated back to the boiler. And look at the TES diagram for the standard cogeneration plant. We will see the point. So, 1, outlet of the boiler, 2, 3, so both are outlet of the boiler, that is inlet to different points. So, 2 is the inlet to the expansion valve, 3 is the inlet to the turbine. So, 3 to 4, this is expansion process. So, after expansion, it goes to the process heater, So, the condition here is 4, it is mixed with the process heater, the steam is coming from 5 from the turbine. So, 3 to 5, it is expansion in the turbine, so it is coming back to the steam is at the condition 5, it is given to the process heater. So, the steam from the, through the expansion valve at condition 4 is entering the process heater. The steam, the bleed steam from the steam turbine, it is at the condition 5, it is also entering the process heater at the point 5. So, this is operating at the pressure P4 equal to P5. Then, the steam turbine, so 3 to 5, expansion is 3 to 5 and 5 to 6. So, 5 to 6 is also expansion in the steam turbine. Then, after 6, it is going to the condenser where the heat is removed, the condition is 8. So, 6 to 8 is the condensation process in the condenser. And with the condition 8, it enters the pump. It is pumped and circulated back to the condition 9. So, it is entering with 9. It is entering the mixing chamber. And you look at 5. So, 5 to 7, it is in the process heater. So, at the end of the process heater, the condition 7 is also saturated liquid. So, the end of this process heater and end of the condenser, it is only saturated liquid. So, 7 to 10, it is again compression. So, in the pump 2. So, it is again becomes 10. Then, with the, actually this mixing chamber is operating a pressure 9 equal to 10. So, P9 equal to P10, and then it is mixed, and then with the pressure 11, P11, it enters the boiler where it is heated and circulated back to the turbine and the expansion valve. So, it is heated to 1. So, it is the steam again, it is recirculated back to the turbine and the expansion valve. So, this is the temperature entropy diagram for the standard cogeneration plant. And this is the layout diagram for the standard cogeneration plant. Suppose there is a question, explain the working of cogeneration plant. So, you have to draw the standard cogeneration plant and explain the process one by one and draw the TS diagram. You try to explain the temperature entropy diagram so that you will give a better idea to the examiner. And for convenience, the pressure is also given here. So P4 equal to 500 kilopascal, P5 equal to 500 kilopascal, 6 equal to 5 kilopascal. Here it is again 5 kilopascal. Everything is enters here and it is 7 kilopascal. So P9 equal to P10 equal to 7 kilopascal. And this is little lower pressure. Then after mixing, the pressure is again 7 kilopascal. With this 7 kilopascal, it goes to the boiler. So it is 7 megapascal and it is going to the boiler. So in the boiler it is heated to 7 megapascal 500 degree Celsius. So this is the temperature entropy diagram for the standard cogeneration plant. And in the cogeneration plant, the one important parameter is utilization factor of the cogeneration plant. So the utilization factor epsilon U equal to net work output from the turbine, steam turbine, plus process heat delivered divided by the total heat input. So everything in kilowatt. So net work output in kilowatt, process heat is in kilojoules per second or kilowatt, and the total heat input is also kilojoules per second or kilowatt. So effectiveness equal to W net plus the heat used for the process and divided by the heat input to the system. That is what the utilization factor. And another next cycle is combined gas and vapor power cycle, or simply combined cycle. So we combine here gas power cycle and the vapor power cycle. So the gas power cycle, gas turbine cycle, and vapor power cycle is the steam cycle or Rankine cycle. So this is the Brayton cycle and this is the vapor power cycle or the Rankine cycle. So why the gas is used at a higher temperature? So this is actually the first cycle is called as topping cycle or the high temperature cycle. And the second cycle is called as bottoming cycle or low temperature cycle. Normally the gas turbine, the combustion chamber, the temperature in the combustion chamber of gas turbine cycle is 1500 degree Celsius to 2000 degree Celsius. Whereas in the case of steam turbine, the inlet temperature is limited to 550 degree Celsius for metallurgical reasons. Because when you condense, the water vapor become water, that is the problem. Whereas in the case of gas turbine, we can operate the gas turbine with a higher temperature, more than 1500 degree Celsius. So that is why gas turbine cycle is a topping cycle and steam cycle or vapor power cycle is the bottoming cycle. So the Brayton cycle, the air enters the compressor. So it is an open cycle. Air enters from the atmosphere, enters the compressor, where it is compressed, the pressure is raised. So the compressor is taking power from the gas turbine. So the power is given to the gas compressor and it is compressed to a higher pressure. The high pressure air, it goes to the combustion chamber where we are supplying the fuel. So the combustion of the fuel is taking place in the combustion chamber. So the hot gases are produced. So the hot gases, they are expanded in the gas turbine to produce power. So the power produced by the turbine, 2/3 of the power is given to the compressor. Only 1/3 of the power is available for external work. So after expansion of the gas turbine, the gases again, still it is hot, higher than, more the temperature of the gases will be more than 500 degrees Celsius. So the hot gases, they are taken to the heat exchanger where it heats the water. So the heat exchanger, it exchanges heat from the hot gases to the water, and after cooling the gases let to the atmosphere, they are called as exhaust gases. Now here water is entering at condition 1, water is entering in the heat exchanger, the water is heated and converted into steam. So the steam at the outlet of the heat exchanger, the outlet steam at the condition 3, it goes to the steam turbine where it is expanded again and the power is produced. So the steam power is produced and the expansion, after expansion, the wet steam. So 0.4 is wet steam, and wet steam goes to the condenser where the heat is removed and it is converted into saturated liquid and it is pumped back to the heat exchanger. So the temperature entropy diagram for the combined gas power, gas vapor power cycle is shown here. So first we take the bottom cycle, that is the steam cycle. So 1 to 2 is the pump work, 2 to 3 is the heating in the heat exchanger, 3 to 4 expansion in the gas turbine, isentropic expansion in the steam turbine, and 4 to 1 it is the condensation. So converting the wet steam into saturated liquid. And the topping cycle, so 5 is the entry point. So 5 is the entry point, air temperature, it is entering the compressor where it is isentropically compressed to a higher pressure. So So with this pressure, it goes to the compression chamber where the temperature of the gas is 7 at the outlet of the compression chamber. So with this temperature T7, the gas goes to the gas turbine, expanded isentropically. 7 to 8 is the isentropic expansion. So the power is produced, and 8 to 9, it is the heat exchanger. So the temperature drop from 8 to 9, it is what utilized for heating the water from T2 to T3. So heat loss by the gas equal to H8 minus H9, and the heat gained by the water equal to H6 minus H2. Right? So that indicates the effectiveness of the heat exchanger. So there should be effective heat transfer between the hot gases and the steam. That is very important. And when there is a question on the combined cycle, so the gas power, vapor power cycle, you draw the layout, draw the temperature entropy diagram, and try to explain the cycle. So explain each component. So the Brayton cycle we studied separately, and the vapor Rankine cycle we studied separately. Now we have combined the Brayton cycle and the Rankine cycle. That is what the combined gas vapor power cycle, or simply combined cycle. And the coupled cycle. So the two vapor power cycles are coupled. So that is called as coupled cycle. So this is one steam cycle, another steam cycle. So this is called as high temperature cycle or the topping cycle, and this is called as low temperature cycle and the bottoming cycle. So the heat, the temperature of the first cycle, the heat temperature outlet or heat outlet of the first cycle is used for heating the second cycle vapor. So this topping, this is called as coupled cycle. The same vapor cycle, same liquid, for example steam cycle, they are coupled. So topping cycle and the bottoming cycle. So topping cycle is high temperature cycle, bottoming cycle is the low temperature cycle. And here the efficiency of the overall efficiency of the coupled cycle, we take eta 1 is the efficiency of the topping cycle, eta 2 is the efficiency of the bottoming cycle, eta is the overall efficiency of the coupled cycle. So we will calculate the overall efficiency of the coupled cycle. So we know eta 1 equal to 1 minus q2 by q1. So from this equation, q2 equal to q1 into 1 minus eta, 1 minus eta 1, and eta 2 equal to 1 minus q3 by q2. So q3 equal to q2 minus 1 minus eta 2. So eta 2 is the efficiency of the second cycle, which is 1 minus heat rejected q3 divided by heat supplied q2. So heat rejected q3 equal to q2 into 1 minus eta 2. And similarly for the topping cycle, eta 1 equal to 1 minus q2 is the heat rejected, and q1 is the heat supplied to the first cycle. So q2 equal to q1 minus 1 minus eta 1. Now we calculate the overall efficiency of the coupled cycle. For coupled cycle, eta equal to 1 minus q3 by q1. So the overall heat rejection is q3 and the overall heat supply is q1. So q3 by q1, so which is 1 minus, so substitute for q3, 1 minus q2 into 1 minus eta 2 by q1 equal to minus, you substitute for q2 now. So 1 minus q1 into 1 minus eta 1 into 1 minus eta 2 divided by q1. So q1 is getting cancelled. So we will get eta equal to 1 minus eta 1 into 1 minus eta 2, simplifying, the overall efficiency of the coupled cycle equal to eta 1 plus eta 2 minus eta 1 eta 2. And this equation is important. Sometimes in the gate examination, using this equation, so the coupled cycle efficiency, for example, efficiency of the first cycle is 30%, efficiency of the second cycle is 40%. So calculate the overall efficiency of the coupled cycle. So then you have to use this equation and find out the overall efficiency. So we stop here. So these are all the reference books I used for preparing the slides. So you can also refer to it for additional information, and you can write to my mail ID for any clarification or queries on the subject. And I have uploaded more than 160 video lectures on thermal engineering subjects, and I have uploaded the solution for the gate questions also. So please subscribe the channel, so which will be useful for your better learning and passing in the gate examination. So thank you very much once again. We'll meet again.